All right, welcome. This is the first lecture for freshwater ecology and aquatic entomology. Well, this is the first lecture for the freshwater ecology module. My name is Carrie LeRoy. I have a PhD in biology with a focus on freshwater ecology, and I'm going to be talking about chapters 1 and 2 today in our textbook. But before we start off, I just thought I would talk a little bit about my background. So I did my PhD work in northern Arizona. And you might wonder why you go to Arizona to study water, but because it's so rare and so precious in the desert, it becomes a hotspot for biodiversity any place you find fresh water. And so I worked in what are called cottonwood riparian zones all across the Southwest, in different streams, and I worked with a really cool research group called the Cottonwood Ecology Group, where we were studying the effects of genetic variation in cottonwood trees on communities and ecosystem processes. And all of these locations that you can see on the map here are hybrid zones, so cottonwood hybridizes. And hybridization is a really key piece of genetic variation. And there's even a really cool documentary called 1,000 Invisible Cords that maybe we can find time to watch at some point in this program. So then, then I moved to Washington State and I started teaching at Evergreen. And since I've been here, I've been able to do all kinds of really exciting research projects with students. Things like looking at Rhytisma punctatum, which is an endophyte in maple leaves, and a fungal endophyte that slows down the decomposition rate of plants. Working on the Elwha Dam removal project and looking at ecosystem processes before and after the removal of those two big dams. Studying interactions between salmon carcasses and leaf litter, two really important what are called allochthonous resources to stream ecosystems, which we'll study more about. And then going on to studying some really cool lakes like Lake Tahoe, Lake Baikal, and more recently studying streams out on the pumice plain of Mount St. Helens after the eruption in 1980. Together with Dylan Fisher and Paul Przybylowicz, helped establish some long-term stream monitoring plots within the Evergreen Ecological Observation Network. And I spent a sabbatical down in Chile working on another volcano, the Calbuco volcano, in Patagonia. And then for about 7 years, I co-directed the Sustainability in Prisons Project, which gave me an opportunity to work on endangered species recovery of a whole variety of species in Washington with incarcerated students. So that's just a brief introduction about me. And moving on, we're going to talk about Washington's rivers and streams. We're going to focus on the differences among some of these streams in Washington, but also talk about streams more broader than Washington. Usually I ask students where, you know, which of these streams do they have a connection to, because a lot of us have strong connections to rivers. There's places of spiritual renewal and recreation and sports and fun things that we like to do in the summertime. So rivers hold a special place for a lot of us. You can also think about rivers in terms of their basins. What area of land do they drain? And so this is a map showing the major basins in Washington. And we live kind of in the Chehalis-Nisqually Basin in Olympia. Depending on where you are, you might be in one part of the watershed or a different watershed. But you can see some of these basins are really large, and then you have smaller basins around the Puget Sound. So basin size varies quite a bit. This is a picture showing all of the lakes in Washington and the different kinds of lakes. So where we live, we have a lot of great glacial drift plain lakes and kettle lakes, which are the bright green spots. There's just a few of those, but they're really cool lakes. There's a lot of glacial scour lakes. There's a lot of oxbow lakes, especially along some of the major rivers, and we'll talk about how those form. Anyway, lots of really cool lakes in Washington to study. This program will mainly focus on rivers and streams, but we'll talk about lakes in small pieces throughout. A lot of what we see in Washington in terms of our freshwater ecosystems was really strongly influenced by the Ice Age floods. So basically, as the continental ice sheet came down, that influenced a lot of streams too. You can see where we live in Olympia, we were covered by ice. But what happened over here, I think you can see that maybe. Yeah, you can see that. We had these glacial dams form and break and then reform hundreds of times out in Montana. So Glacial Lake Missoula is probably the best well-known. And when those dams broke, you got this amazing flood event across all of the channeled scablands of eastern Washington, and then the water was forced through the Columbia River channel here, and the water backed up into the Willamette River and then came out at the mouth of the Columbia. And in doing so, created some really crazy features, things like a lot of the scour lakes and Merrimictic lakes in the east side, but also created massive rivers on the scale that are pretty much unimaginable. So some really cool history there.